In August 1883, a sound like cannon fire reached sailors all over the Indian Ocean. From Sri Lanka to Australia to a remote island you'd never heard of called Rodriguez, people heard the blast. All these reports told the story of a massive sound wave that had traveled nearly 5,000 kilometers and was heard across 1/13th of the entire planet. It was the loudest sound ever recorded on Earth. And the source of that wave was a humongous volcanic explosion that obliterated the Indonesian island of Krakatoa. It's hard to even grasp how loud something has to be for its sound waves to cover an area bigger than the continental United States. Even a painfully loud sound, like a cannon fire, can be inaudible when it's over a few kilometers away. But the loudness of this explosion was completely off the charts, which got me wondering, how loud can something get? And what could make the loudest possible sound? For you to perceive something as loud, two things have to happen. First, some event has to make a powerful sound wave, and then that sound wave has to interact with your body. In other words, a tree has to fall in the forest, and you have to hear it. When a tree falls and smashes into the ground, it forces a bunch of energy into the surrounding air and ground particles. Those particles then smash into their neighbors, and so on. Basically, the whole thing starts acting like a kind of vibrating slinky. Specifically, a slinky that's vibrating like this, where a wave shoots down the length of the spring, carrying a bunch of energy along with it. Now, instead of watching the wave travel down the whole slinky, focus in on just one section. As the rings squeeze together and stretch apart, you'll notice that the individual rings only move a little bit before returning to their original position. So, sound waves are like slinkies, but they don't have to be made out of metal. They can be made out of a solid block of rock, or water, or, as we're mostly used to dealing with, air. But whichever medium we're dealing with, it's not rings that are being squished together and then stretched apart. It's groups of molecules. And this alternating squishing and stretching creates bands of high and low pressure that you can measure with a pressure meter. The greater the difference between these two pressure areas, the more energy the wave is carrying, and the louder that sound should be, right? Well, kinda. The sound you hear standing in the forest and listening to a tree fall isn't a direct measure of that pressure wave or the energy that's traveling through the air, because hearing is a sense. Those slinky-like vibrations move through the air and set off vibrations in our ears. They vibrate our eardrum, our ear bones, and a bunch of fluid well beyond where the Q-tip goes, despite every medical expert telling you not to put Q-tips deep in your ear. That fluid that bends a bunch of little hair cells that convert those vibrations into nerve signals, which goes to our brain and gets converted again into the sensation of sound. It's amazing, but it doesn't work for all the frequencies that sound waves can come in. Plenty of sounds, like elephant rumbles or bat calls, happen outside the range of frequencies that our bodies can convert into audible sensations. And even within that range, we're more sensitive to certain frequencies, like the ones that correspond to human voices. Which is great. It means we, or the people trying to communicate with us, aren't constantly getting drowned out by low-pitched noises like the wind. But it also means that what we perceive as loudness doesn't just depend on how much energy a sound has. It depends on our bodies and how we process the sound waves that are carrying that energy. So answering the question of what is the loudest sound kind of depends on who or what is detecting it. But that said, we do have common ways of describing loudness. Most of the time, we use units called decibels to talk about how loud a rock concert is or how much loudness we can cut out with earplugs. The only problem is, decibels don't actually measure loudness. They just tell us how intense a sound wave is at a certain distance from the source. In other words, decibels tell you what happens when a tree falls in the forest, how much energy turns into sound waves rippling through the air. But they don't say anything about how those sound waves interact with your body. And decibel measurement isn't an absolute measurement in the way that an object's mass or length is. It's not like taking a ruler or a scale to a sound wave and measuring it directly. It's actually a ratio. To calculate a decibel value, you need to compare the intensity of the sound wave to a certain reference point. We typically use a reference point based on a sound wave traveling through the air with a frequency of 1,000 hertz at an intensity that's right around the lower threshold of human hearing. It's a useful pick because that way a label of 0 decibels aligns with the lower limit of our hearing. So the whole decibel scale is tuned around how humans hear in normal conditions on Earth. But it doesn't have to be. And the decibel scale also reflects the way we perceive sound by increasing the same way our hearing does, on what's called a logarithmic scale. Basically, that means when a sound seems to double in loudness, it's actually getting 10 times more intense. The logarithmic scale lets us represent the huge range of intensities that humans hear with a relatively small range of numbers. But even though it's tuned to our hearing, a decibel measurement still doesn't actually reflect how much sound we'll hear. You could have a bat making calls that register higher on the decibel scale than a rock concert, but even standing right next to that bat, you'd hear nothing. So decibels alone can't fully describe the sensation of loudness. But for the sake of this video, let's imagine that we could hear every kind of acoustic wave just as well as any other, no matter what frequency. And in those terms, let's see what would make the loudest sound.
Thanks to Skillshare for supporting this SciShow video. Skillshare is the largest online learning community for creatives, with thousands of classes led by industry experts in crafts, baking, business, film, or productivity. They even have one class that helps with all of those things. It's Ali Abdal's Productivity for Creators: Systems, Organization, and Workflow. This class has 18 bite-sized lessons that are only a few minutes each with no ads. And at the end, there's a bonus interview. So if you're trying to get motivated, make time in your busy life, be more efficient with that time, and stay consistent, this is the class to try. And if you already have all of that figured out, well, congrats. But even you can get plenty out of Skillshare because they're always launching new premium classes. To check them out, you can go to the link in the description. The first 500 people to click that link will get a 1-month free trial of Skillshare.
Since there weren't any measurements of the Krakatoa explosion made anywhere near the volcano itself, we don't know exactly how high it reached on the decibel scale. But about 150 kilometers away, a pressure meter measured a spike that corresponded to around 173 decibels. That's around 2,000 times more intense than the sound of a gunshot right next to you. And as you get closer to the site of the explosion, that reading would get higher, and the sound would get louder, until it hit the limit of how loud a sound wave can get. Because here's the thing. A sound wave can't get infinitely intense, no matter how much energy something pumps into the air. Remember how sound moves through the air by scrunching and stretching its molecules like a slinky? Well, the more energy a sound wave has, the tighter molecules squeeze together in the peaks of the wave, and the more they spread out in the troughs of the wave. But eventually, the particles in the troughs spread out so much that the space is just empty. It can't go any further. The troughs physically can't get any emptier. In air, at sea level and 0 degrees Celsius, sound waves hit this physical limit at 194 decibels. And if that doesn't sound like a mind-bogglingly large number, keep in mind that the decibel scale is logarithmic. 194 decibels is hundreds of millions of times more intense than the sound in the front row of a rock concert, which is around 110 decibels. In liquid or solid mediums, that limit is even higher because, for reasons we won't go into today, their molecules actually can withstand a certain amount of pressure below zero. That happens when the molecules get stretched apart a little, so the pressure inside the medium drops lower than the pressure around it, even when that surrounding pressure is zero. The pressure still can't drop infinitely low, but it takes longer to run into a physical limit. So in something like water, sound can be around 400 million times more intense than in air. These decibel limits are ridiculously high. But when Krakatoa exploded, the wave that raced through the air definitely started above that 194 decibel limit. And in an extreme situation like this, when something rattles the air with enough energy to exceed that limit, that energy still needs to go somewhere. So you end up with a kind of pressure wave that's not technically a sound wave anymore, but it'll still shake your eardrums, and you'll still hear it if the frequency is within our hearing range. It's called a shockwave. A shockwave is what happens when a sound wave reaches the maximum possible intensity. At this point, the wave troughs can't get any emptier, but the molecules in those peak regions can still squeeze together tighter. And when that happens, the peaks of the wave start traveling faster than the troughs. That's because the energy from the sound wave travels faster through denser areas. For relatively weak waves, this isn't a big effect. But at this level of intensity, it becomes really noticeable. The shape of the wave gets distorted from something that's nice and symmetrical into something that resembles a sawtooth. Shockwaves travel faster and lose energy faster than regular sound waves, but they're still audible. And since they have a sharp wave front instead of a gradual one, you'll hear all the wave's energy hit around the same time, in a big boom or crack. So in some sense, we can still think about it like a sound. But unlike a sound wave, there's basically no limit to how intense a shockwave can get. The one from Krakatoa shattered windows, cracked walls, and knocked over furniture over 100 kilometers away. In the days after the blast, it even registered on pressure meters around the world because it kept wrapping around the planet. But of course, this isn't the only time humans have witnessed a colossal shockwave shake things up. In 1908, an asteroid exploded in the air over Siberia, releasing over 300 times as much energy as the atomic bomb dropped on Hiroshima. We don't know exactly where the blast registered on the decibel scale, but its shockwave flattened trees that were spread across an area over 2,000 square kilometers. And these days, non-natural events can produce incredibly loud shockwaves too. The explosion of 1 kilogram of TNT can hit 185 decibels if you're standing within 5 meters of it, which I would not recommend doing, and not just because it would rupture your eardrums. Shockwaves can mess you up in all sorts of ways besides hearing loss, causing your lungs to collapse, various other organ damage, or even death. In 1983, Soviet scientists did an underground nuclear test whose shockwaves produced a record-breaking pressure that was around 7 billion times the pressure of the Earth's atmosphere. If anyone had been up close, they would have experienced a 390-decibel explosion, which at that point, you're not hearing because it's not just your eardrums that are long gone, it's all of you. That is inconceivably loud. But if we could hear sound waves and shock waves beyond our planet, some of those would completely dwarf our nuclear blasts and Krakatoa. Fortunately, we don't hear sounds from space on Earth because there's no air in space to carry them to us. But that doesn't mean there are none. Black holes can send sound waves billowing through the gas around them, and supernova explosions ripple through the cast-off shells of stellar debris they formed inside. It's hard to directly compare these sounds to what we hear on Earth, because they're passing through a different kind of medium than air. But what we can say is that the most powerful supernova ever observed was this many times more energetic than Krakatoa. Even though we don't know exactly how much of that energy went into the shockwave that rippled through the surrounding gas, there's no way around the fact that these waves absolutely blow Krakatoa out of the water. Even more than Krakatoa blew itself out of the water.